director for the Electric Energy Systems Group and director of the recently formed SRC Smart Grid Research Center. And, so, here is Dr. Sonic from the University of San Francisco. And he became an assistant professor at Cornell University and Drexel University before she joined the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign as an associate professor. And from there, she went to
getting back. I have to say I feel like a robot with all this, so please excuse my look here. So good afternoon. I'm very happy to be here, and thank you for coming. It's not going to be an easy job for me to talk about the subject because people come with very different backgrounds. So if I were to do very detailed technical talk, it would look like something else. But you know, as you all know, there is so much going on in the field and there are changes. And I'm going to try, I don't know how successful I'll be, to give you a little bit of a big picture and then go into more details on why you know, we think that this is really an intellectually challenging area and what does it have to do in common with some more general disciplines. So what we've been working on at CMU now for quite some time, it was an NSF ITR project that started when I got to CMU and now is being funded by the center that we got and some industry sponsors, is this idea of dynamic monitoring and decision systems for sustainable energy services. And it is quite a change of paradigm, and I'm going to try to explain the reasons for this and how it all fits into a lot of other things that are happening in the energy area. So let me try. So to start with, I just want to acknowledge the group. There are a lot of students. We have like 20 students in the engineering side and 10, 15 students in the also engineering, but more on the policy side. So it's quite multidisciplinary group. And under this NSF work, et cetera, we have managed from the beginning to have teams in which you have domain experts working with communications control people, et cetera. So it's taken a long time to learn how to pose the problems and have the common language. But I think we are making some progress. And I want to share that with you. Most recently, as Mustafa mentioned, SRC, Semiconductor Research Corporation, started, showed an interest and took initiative in forming some centers in the energy area, which has not been a domain of SRC in the past. And the reason was basically because this industry has seen an opportunity to deploy semiconductors, nanotechnology, et cetera, for photovoltaics and solar. So the way the Energy Research Initiative started at Purdue was they started by forming one center on photovoltaics, which is led now by at Purdue. And then IBM, which already was a member of Purdue University Center in Photovoltaics, came and said, how are you going to integrate large amounts of photovoltaics, et cetera, if you don't know how the system should be managed? So they sort of made the case for Smart Grid Center, and after some review, you know, CMU got selected to lead that center. They are still to, the plan is to still open one center on energy storage. The lead university is to be still determined. So the sort of the motivating theme is to enable integration of renewable energy resources and to, at the same time as these resources come on the system for primarily environmental reasons, still keep the system reliable and under cost control, so it's not too expensive. And Here is a very quick summary of the center and the sort of specific areas that are being pursued now. The typical SRC model, but these are things that we are working on. There are several different teams, but as you can see, there is a lot of systems related stuff. The first thing is, can we actually go from the fundamentals and model a smart grid, you know, emulate, have the simulator in which you show causes and effects and do analysis and show how different regions drive the drive the performance, et cetera. There's a lot of work, as you know, I just came from Berkeley, half of Berkeley is working on smart building, efficient buildings, that all falls under the category of demand side management, smart grids. Then you can make transmission distribution systems not be as just passive wires, and they used to be in the past, but you can have power electronically switch controls of storage devices and goes under the area of facts, and how to deploy a lot of controls at that time scale of the wires in order to help the dynamic performance of the entire system. We have a young faculty, Gabriela Hoog, that we just hired from ETH, who has been working, that's her specialty. She's been working with Morari and Anderson on that, so that's her area. There is a lot of work going on data management, verification. CMU is it's quite known for those things. And then on the EPP side, engineering public policy side, there is the fundamental question. No, it doesn't matter how well you do the technical things. How should one change or design the policies to support the IT-enabled innovations in physical infrastructures. It's a big area. A lot of people on the policy side are working on that. So these are the first set of trust areas, and this is going to evolve over time. Right now, CMU is the lead, but the plan is to have maybe some multi-university engagement, and we talked a little bit about possible collaborations today. So that's just in lieu of just acknowledgments and what's going on the funding side. But these are some things that I would like to talk about, and most likely I'm going to run out of time, so I'll see how it goes, how fast I go. But the first thing I want to just address very quickly, the question that about the energy system education, more so than just research at US universities, show you this think that this was sort of, I talked to myself and I decided that this is like a cycle that we have in the economics. We have good periods for the education, comes down and goes, and so where are we now? But one thing that's really very clear is that this is potentially once in a lifetime opportunity for system integration and to move the energy systems into next generation, into smarter services. And the question is how to do that. So I want to emphasize this and share some potential for gains, which are, in many ways, they are low-hanging fruit. It's not really just all fundamental long-term research, but it needs to be done. Then I will turn more to technical things on addressing this question. So there are sort of two types of communities. There are people who worry about climate change and sustainability, and people who do engineering design. What do these two things have in common? So one concept that we've put forward is that transmission, T&D, and operation of the system, of the grid, is no longer doesn't network-centric. You're not doing it for the purpose of keeping the grid together. But you are doing it in order to enable as efficient, as clean integration of and cost-effective integration of the resources. So it's the entire. So the T&D becomes an enabler of something else. And that is the link between the engineering side of the power grid and, you know, the whole social objectives on sustainability, etc. I have been quite taken by these concepts, but I'm not going to have time to talk about it much. Socio-ecological systems concepts that the recent Nobel Prize winner, first woman in economics, winner Eleanor Ostrom from Purdue, from Indiana University, she's talking about looking at social ecological systems and looking at some features of the architectures which are going to tell you if this, how sustainable is the system likely to be, depending on the architectures and characteristics of resources, etc. There is going to be a special issue on proceedings of IEEE in January in which some of these things will be described, but I strongly recommend looking, because I'm not going to have time to talk about it, but this is another link, because she talks about interaction variables between resources and demand side. We have actually looked into those things from the engineering side, but the two were never put together. And our students are having a lot of fun putting the two things together. I want to spend, if I have time, more on taking the step back and saying, okay, why is the today's models and analysis that we have in traditional books and power systems need to be revised or enhanced in order to actually begin to design for these different purposes? And what is the fundamental challenge? And I don't want to leave without saying that if we start from scratch, as though nothing was done during the years of less things support at the Department of Energy, etc., it's going to take us 30 years to redo it. So the big challenge is how to build on the knowledge that already exists and put all those pieces of puzzles together to create something new. So the first thing on education, I think this is sort of self-explanatory, but I wanted to, there was recently a gathering of ESEDA, Electric Computer Engineering Department Heads Association on Power System Education, and there was a lot of discussion, and something like this came out. Everybody is recognizing that, you know, there is no real commitment to electric energy systems education. But if you look through, you know, since the beginning of 20th century, it was a very hot area. Then something happens, you know, it was not viewed as a science anymore. Then there was in late 80s, etc., there was this revival of interest in electric energy, but it was primarily from the reasons of economics and regulatory structure and policy making. And then people realized 10 years after that, it's really interesting to look at the summary, that we actually designed these markets. And so now they're not working. So economists and policymakers are losing faith that this can work, but it never was actually designed. And Kyle is here from CMU. You know, we have had infinite discussions on this, what it would take to align the objectives of operations and with the market design, because market for electricity is not quite the same as market for apples and oranges. And most recently, this is where we are now, just in a short summary. We have now different drivers for education, and there is a lot of excitement pretty much every school. You know, there are a lot of young people interested in energy for and environment connections as key social goals, but a lot of young people that what I see, they are really interested in seeing this happen, and they don't think about energy systems as an old area anymore. What here is the real danger, and you know, as we've gone through, as the system has gone through different evolution, and we actually have an overwhelming complexity in which change is driven by technology breakthroughs, social drivers, etc., and there is a real, very real danger of missing the expectations. So there is, you know, as you know, stimulus money, a lot put into this area, etc. How are we going to make something, some impact, and move the industry forward on actually show some tangible benefits? It's not clear. It's potentially actually the next bust. And if that happens, I don't know what to tell young people. You know, then again, there is another problem. Okay. But on a little brighter side, this is just, you know, how it fits into. We are spending a lot of time, and I've seen it at many schools, you know, as we talk to different colleagues, that what is happening and that is interesting is that people are recognizing more and more it's not just the physics, it's just modeling of complex systems, dependence on. This is a very interesting one to me, that we have, in the past, we have modeled systems and dynamics as driven by fundamental principles. Now, the models actually depend very much on what you sense, and they are decision-making driven and control-driven, actuators-driven, much more so that the closed-loop models become much more dominant things than just modeling the natural dynamics of the system. And so the question is then, the research question is where to put sensors, how to design the control so that you have desired performance. Okay. And you need to, for control centers and for different intelligence to be embedded in different layers of the changing industry, you need numerical methods and algorithms to actually convert these models into something that's going to facilitate the decision making. So it boils down to thinking about how to bring IT into work, to work to meet these goals that are set ahead of the community. And so I made this slide recently as part of sort of trying to make the case, where are we and what's new and what is the potential? So why, you know, who should be participating? But the most interesting, important part is that in summary, if you look at the smart grids and stimulus money that's gone into different demonstration and tests, there is a very real opportunity and challenge here to do large scale, national scale integration of coordinated power systems by really integrating then a physical energy system in which you have the physical grid, its power electronics, energy resources, or physics, overlaid with communications, with control systems, and economic and policy systems. It's never been thought about that way. It has never been done that way. So this is the opportunity. And there is very little, actually, vision and leadership in thinking about the problem that way. There are already some estimates of, if you were to do something like this, what is the potential benefit? They are very likely conservative. So this is the FERC, Federal Energy Regulatory Commission estimate, that you can have easily 20% increase in economic efficiency just by doing smarter scheduling of the existing resources. Everything else the same. That's huge. That means not building 20% new generation. And then the other thing which is real challenge is, so the society is committed to renewables for environmental reasons. If you follow today's operating and planning industry procedures, we are going to end up with the need for a lot of reserves. In other words, the rule, operating reserve, is that you have to have enough reserve for the worst case. Worst case is when the wind doesn't blow at all, plus a conventional power plant fails, and you have to have extra power for that. That's the reliability standard in the country, without relying on anything in real time, sensing or adaptation. Well, that is going to, we can do this, but you're going to end up with very, very expensive electricity service. It'll defeat the purpose. It's not sustainable because it's just too expensive. So one way is to begin, and I'm going to talk a little more, how to change this paradigm of worst case design approach for reliability, which is deterministic, doesn't rely at all on near real-time decision-making or sensing, into something else that would make, which would reduce the cost as you integrate intermittent resources, which are very stochastic. And then there has been a lot of work in the literature. There has not been technology transfer, but after the blackout of 2003, it was shown, even industry academic people, they have co-author papers in which they have shown that with very little coordination, blackout of 2003 should have never happened. I mean, that's a huge claim. It just comes from IT. And then this one is big also, and it has a big dollar, you know, costs associated with it. How to expand the infrastructure for maximum benefit and minimum, you know, environmental intrusion. Where do you put in these complex systems what are the best technologies? Where do you put them? What do you sense? How do you use? So how do you have methods for finding the most critical locations where, if you were to enhance the system, things would be much better? So all this is why, you know, this is the sort of very tall order that one can do. And who? Must be university-led, really, because it's huge intellectual challenge. We can talk for a long time about the state of R&D in the industry itself. If there is no leadership here, I think this is just too hard. You know, it's gotten too complex, and it's almost too hard to even give it a try. But universities could make the difference there, and they should partner with with different, you know, government and partners and technologists, which are not necessarily, you've seen in the media and in different popular things, a lot of interest by Google, by Cisco, etc. They want to deploy their technologies, but I think we need to work with them to see how the technologies fit in to facilitate what needs to be done on the power system. So working with technologies doesn't mean just working with General Electric to design the best next machine. It's also all this high tech, how should be deployed and for what purpose. Okay, so this slide is from my department head, Ed Schlesinger, who loves to draw this parallel between what happened in electronic industry and what made the real difference. And he draws direct parallel between that and what ought to happen in the power industry. So the take is that electronic technology has fundamentally altered the way we live in everything, communications, commerce, entertainment. But the key to change have been integrated circuits, which have been developed in a manner that provides ever-growing information handling power at the ever-decreasing cost. That is it. And key to the development of these technology systems on chips, I mean, this is Santa Barbara is very big in this, is really the ability to model and design these systems and the associated development of software systems. Two things. And I mean, this is why our department head at CMU in electrical engineering is supportive of the energy area, because he basically is saying that similar application, the creation of smart grids, is the application of information technology while coupling it with understanding of business and regulatory environment. Okay, so it's IT, you know, making it happen. And in order to do that, so several things going on here. So if one just thinks about this statement, that means, okay, I just go and I put some, you know, platform, IT platforms, and I'm done. What is not going to work that way, because in order to decide what information to put in, to exchange between different entities, in order to decide what intelligence to embed into different layers, we really have to continue our traditional way of thinking about power systems. Otherwise, the industry will never adapt it. In other words, we have to have sound models which are going to make the case. If I have this control, if I have that information, this is the likely performance, I can simulate things, etc. So the big tall order for modeling future systems, development on command and control for to integrate these new drivers, and even some other important things now, the security and safety, which actually are newer to the picture, but they are very relevant. So the big point here is that this is what we are not doing with stimulus money. We are deploying, we are testing before we actually model and simulate what can happen. So this is, again, Ed's big thing, that we have to do these things before we actually deploy hardware. And so one sort of daunting task is how to verify, how to do test beds for these large systems. Well, that question has to be addressed, but we are not there. We don't have emulators. We don't have simulators on what's happening with the new industry and with the new drivers. So one approach that we have taken, and this is sort of the idea based on which we won the SRC Center, is we call it dynamic monitoring and decision systems. And you can see that women have designed this, you know, so women like diamonds, right? But anyway, so it's nothing else. If you think about that from the systems point of view and from control point of view, there are different diamonds, different dynamic monitoring decision systems that need to be embedded into different layers of hardware, or how appliances, households, residential loads. And so the green things are the new hardware, new technologies, you know, solar, wind, pumped hydro, etc. But equally, as you embed new intelligence into those new resources, you have to embed a lot of intelligence into demand side. And so the state of art is basically that if you think about this is in a sort of 1 minute crash course on power systems. This is your mesh network, extra high voltage mesh network, and then you have radial network at lower voltages. So these dotted blue lines are basically the today's SCADA, supervisory control and data acquisition system, which is basically the monitoring and information exchange system between control center down to the substation level. And it doesn't go any further down to the end users. So imagine now what's happening. You are deploying, you are testing advanced meter infrastructures here, but there is no information going from there back. So that when the system operator decides how much of conventional generation to schedule to balance the system, they have no clue what's happening on the demand side. So what we are saying, the first thing is a sort of next generation SCADA that you have to design in order to extend the information exchange that exists down to substation level into multi-directional information exchange. So if you go into math, and I'll give you some examples of this, it is necessary to provide information from top down to the lower layers and at the same way from the bottom up. And this interactive information exchange actually creates the basis for new models and for the evolution of the system state rather than just having one equilibrium. There is no equilibrium. So it's all driven by the information exchange. If you do it that way, then you can begin to understand. Then you begin to understand how one can bring new functionalities to the system that we really have in today's power systems. So we are very fond of these concepts, just in time, just in place, just in context. Just in time means, okay, so I'm demand side, let's say, I'm household or neighborhood, etc. I need to predict what my load is. I need to know my characteristics or characteristics of groups of users. I need to make decisions in the dynamic look ahead way, not in the static way. So one thing that's made electricity prices volatile, that's made brought a lot of wear and tear to dispatch the we do it now, is basically you predict something for the next hour. You forget what happened before. You are not thinking about what's going to happen in the future. So you just reschedule things now, and then you forget all about it. You do least square estimation, whatever, minimum linear programming or whatever to decide which resources need to be scheduled. Statically, forget about any trends, any stochastic nature of the problem, and off you go. So as you do the scheduling, things jerk up and down. So within 2 hours, you can take the plant up and down, etc. And that is really not the way to do. If you think about the problem, you really need to smooth out things by looking through having the predictions. And also things like dynamic distributed decision making, model predictive control, and things like that for people who are in that area. They are going to, we have begun to show that if you embed this intelligence to demand side, to wind power plants, to conventional plants, and actually PJM, one of the large ISOs, is beginning to go in that direction, sort of more of a rudimentary version of this look ahead. They call it two-step unit commitment. Then you can, as things change, you can adjust in time and not have to in a fairly smooth way. So just-in-time functionality is very important. Just-in-place is very critical for complex networks like power systems because you have to deliver it at the right place. You know, it has to balance at each node. And so that brings the notions of distributed, interactive, multi-layered, not just one, homogeneous system. Just in context is a sort of functionality that we still have problems with, but basically, sort of formalizing, the idea is that as the industry has restructured, there is no one single entity in control. So who should be doing what, and what information should be given to whom in order for the system as a whole to work well? So performance objectives, organizational role and responsibility, and design for that function of system conditions. This is a big area. This is where multi-agents come, etc. Okay. So please interrupt me any time because I don't know how fast I'm going, etc. So let me go a little bit more into technical things. So if I am a person interested in systems, why is this an important thing? Is there something new? A lot of people say, well, it was done in the 80s and maybe there is nothing new. So I'll try just, it is not going to be complete, but just a little bit of some main ideas. As I mentioned before, we really have to look very carefully into new modeling paradigms. Models are driven by sensing, communication, and decision making, and automation. So one example of this is, in traditional power systems, we model dynamics of generators, but loads are just estimated forecasts. They are just disturbances, right? Now you can put measurements on the at load centers, do model identification, convert the load model into dynamic model, and the model of the interconnected system is not set of differential algebraic equation, becomes set of ordinary differential equations because everything has a dynamics in every node. So these sort of very interesting switch and simplifications in the design and control and challenges brought about by having more sensing and model identification, different layers, I think it's going to be key. So I want to show a little bit on that. Then the next thing is, okay, so we do model for the sake of modeling, and there are at least three different categories, three different timescales where things have to be revisited and the control and decision making should be, it becomes a little bit more complex, so more work is needed as we have different type of resources and technologies on the system. The first one is, once we have these models, we need to introduce next generation dispatch unit commitment methods which are better suited to manage intermittency. And so several things going on here. Demand is active decision maker. You know, if the demand participates in balancing the system, then you may not have to switch some other power plant on. So there, you know, you have more decision makers. Also, Shmuel Oren from Berkeley and some other people, they are arguing that as you do economic dispatch for supply, for balancing supply and demand, you can actually proactively disconnect and connect lines, change the topology. So it's more optimal if you know where you do the switching also. Perhaps the most important thing, which is here on the slide, I mentioned it earlier, is this, you can no longer do things in a deterministic static way. You have to do smoothing out by predictions and dynamic look ahead. If you don't do that, then you know, you have some, I'll show you some slides how different things are depending on how you do your dispatch, just some representative things. Short-term stabilization using online sensing and adaptation, this is a huge area. For the first time you have these phasor measurement units, you can have 12 samples within one cycle. What do you do with data information? Where do you put these measurements and how do you begin to close the loop? We have put, there is a lot of stimulus money that's gone into putting the sensors those. Very little work on how do you close the loop and why you close the loop. So it's really a sort of golden opportunity for systems guys.
Where does that
PMUs.
Where is this
information aggregated? Well, right now there are these PMU concentrators, you know, like Chow is working on one for the Northeast for aggregating information from whatever PMUs get deployed in New York and New England into one server that collects them all. There is one PNL, Pacific National Lab. They're doing one which is even larger area, sort of Midwest and West. And so there are a few of these concentrators. Okay, you can have dedicated communication scheme, you can do anything. The question is, should you combine them with the existing scale? Just have more accurate measurements at some locations and the communication scheme is the same. You collect it in the control center or you can do dedicated schemes. That's a research question also. We talked about this over lunch a little bit. I don't have time to talk about this. I could talk forever because I'm really excited about this. So the power electronics, I don't know if there is anybody working in power electronics here. There is a lot of power electronics being deployed now to control, let's say, to stabilize the wind power plants, etc., solar, to make sure that these new devices, before they get connected to the grid, meet the interconnection standards. That's all being implemented with the power electronics. The question is, how can you meet the standard, one by one standard? Let's say I designed the power electronics for this wind power plant to do something, doesn't matter what it is connected to, and you do for all of them and then put them in the system. The only way to do that separation is through high gain control at the module by module level. And I spent a lot of time yesterday with Seth Sanders at Berkeley, whose area is, you know, this goes also into energy efficiency devices. You know, you do the variable speed drives, you control them in using high gain, otherwise you cannot really have guaranteed performance. So the whole area of power electronic switching and the best control logic for making sure that you don't have instabilities due to very fast fluctuations in wind, for example, or solar, I think it's just, we are starting from scratch there. It's just the beginning. This one is, you know, people who worked in the area, they are very familiar. Automatic generation control, voltage control, flow control. Why is this a new problem? Now you have much more accurate measurements. Would that help or not? I have some students who are working on demand actually doing balancing at the time scale that generators were doing in the automatic generation control. Well, demand wants to do it, how to implement, etc. So from the optimization point of view, we have very big paradigm shift in which today's transmission grid, basically its objective is to deliver supply to meet given demand. There is no decision making at the demand side. Everything else is a constraint. You know, you do it so that power flow equations balance, that you don't exceed congestion, etc. This enabling transmission grid is doing something very different. Deliver power to support supply and demand schedules in which both supply and demand have cost assigned. So it becomes all the optimization. There is no constraint. You internalize the constraint, and therefore you can design the incentives in the markets, etc. You deliver electricity at quality of service determined by the customer's willingness to pay. So you avoid the problem that just arose in California, in which customers at the end of the month get this huge bill. And I'll show you a little bit with adaptive load management, just some examples of how actually it's very straightforward to do it if you think about it. So let me get moving here. So adaptive load management. So this is the student working on it. So this is the conventional power system. These wiggles are generators, arrows are loads for people who are not familiar with it. And so you start putting wind. It's a disturbance, right? How can you compensate wind? You can compensate many different ways. One way to do it is to have demand responsive to fluctuations, right? And can respond either to the price that they see or to the frequency locally, depending on which time scale you are in. So JY, we call her, she basically is working on embedding, developing these diamonds. So you basically optimize, group of customers optimizes their expected benefit for the anticipated prices on the system, creates the bid curves, the willingness by of the customers to buy so much kilowatt hours at that price as a result of their distributed optimization for the anticipated demand. That information gets given to the control center, and the control center clears. So basically, there is a choice. The demand says, okay, any solution that you give me between here and here is acceptable, it's feasible solution. It's up to the system operator to actually choose the one when he thinks about the system at all. So that's that interactive thing. These dots here mean here that if the anticipated price is 5, I'm just doing just one, a single variable optimization, I decide what quantity to buy to maximize my benefit. I can bring risks and uncertainties into that through look ahead, etc. So you do finer and finer internalization of uncertainties, intertemporal constraints. But for anticipated price, you get one optimal solution for another. So now you don't believe anticipated prices is going to change a little bit. You redo the optimization, you create the demand curve. So somebody, I'm spending my sabbatical at MIT, I was showing this, and somebody said, well, this is, if you're going to do the decomposition of stochastic system, you have to exchange the functions rather than points. Well, the function happens to be here, a demand side, a demand curve. So that, therefore, the link with economics.
How do you change demand at the same time scale?
You can do it many different ways. What she's doing is here. I didn't bring that example. I can give you the paper if you want. So basically, assume that the demand is air conditioners, right? So you know the dynamics. So there is some inertia in the room temperature. So you project for the next 24 hours. What is the temperature going to be? What is your preference temperature? And then what is the likely price of electricity? And you create these schedules for which hour you would like how much to consume, at what price, at what anticipated price. So you create one demand curve for each hour. And you give that as a bid to the system operator, and the market clears. So it's a very straightforward distributed dynamic programming thing for anticipated price. And then you basically implement by changing the thermostat, right, in an automated way, so that the room temperature actually, so you are controlling how much power you are going to get within the range that finally clears, but by this optimization you are guaranteeing that you are staying within that. So the entire smart buildings, efficient buildings, it's sort of based on that principle. We just finished the paper, and I don't know if I can send it to you if it's complete done, but I could do that soon. Yes. Absolutely. Yes. And this is something very, very new that we didn't exploit in the past. The other thing is, PNNL came with this patent that was actually published by Fred Schweppe 30 years ago on the homeostatic control. Basically, you can put little sensors, frequency sensors in your washers and dryers. So as the frequency comes down, you slow down its variable speed thing. So that's a different inertia. It's much faster. But if you have millions of these doing, in a very automated way, just senses frequency, not price, that's not like look ahead 24 hours, But it's just almost instant. It's not instantaneous, like every 10 minutes or something you can adjust to frequency change. And the concept that Fred put many years ago, the homeostatic control, is that if everybody were to do this in appliances, frequency regulates you back to 60 hertz in a homeostatic way, you don't need to have another fast gas plant to actually follow wind. So, I mean, it just blows your mind in a hurry, but it's if you think about it from the systems point of view, it's really not a big deal. It's just putting the pieces of puzzle together. Okay, so JY is struggling a lot with this because now the question is, okay, I have one optimization. I want the market. I have to decide what information the end user is going to give back to the aggregator. How is the aggregator going to buy electricity on a slower time scale from the wholesale market? What is the how is this anticipated price by the market created? What is the information exchange between the aggregator and the individual users? This really becomes, I just mentioned to you the demand function because I'm going very fast, but basically the anticipated price is a result of clearing between supply and demand, and that feeds the distributed decision making to decide on the quantity. Is decomposition using Lagrangian decomposition, so on, et cetera. If you do it, this is a fundamentally different concept than direct load control that utilities are doing nowadays. Utilities basically have this contract. Let's say this is a utility, or here utility says, I have an agreement that this is going to be fixed tariff 5 for the next year, so that I can interrupt you 15 times a year. Doesn't tell you, give you warning, anything, just disconnects you. And the electricity bills comes at the end to be something, okay? Here there is adaptation, there is choice. So this is how distributed stuff comes together with coordination. For the anticipated conditions, you decide on the range of acceptable things, and then the higher level things select so that you have system-wide or on particular layer objectives met. So you sort of reconcile this very difficult thing of systems objective and distributed objectives in an interactive way. So Lushi is a new faculty member at Texas A&M, our student, so he spent the whole thing to show that, forget about demand side. If you want to integrate here to replace some conventional generation by 20-50% penetration of wind, how can you do it? and just some very fine differences, and I'll stop. I don't have time to talk about AGC. Very interesting things going on temporally. This blue is anticipated system demand as we know it now. It's pretty smooth. By the time, if I treat wind as a negative demand, right, then by the time I subtract the wind, which is very volatile, my demand is going to look like this. That means that I have to schedule these power plants, in particular fast power plants, gas plants, very fast so that they compensate for these perturbations. And the important thing is that different technologies have different ramping rates. They can only respond so fast, right? So what happens? Here is where the math and the methods and algorithms begin to make the difference. If I can show this very quickly. So let's say this is wind generation. So wind was pretty smooth, and then suddenly you have surge of wind. So instead of having the smooth demand now because wind didn't blow, you have this that needs to be compensated. You can do that different ways. This dotted line is, remember adaptive demand that I showed? You can actually respond to price or to local frequency doing homeostatic. And as wind doesn't blow, you cut back on the demand in an automated way and the system balances. So the effective demand is no longer smooth. After the demand responded, it responds in such a way that it still balances in the distributed way. Why is this such a big deal? This is such a big deal because if I don't have this elastic demand, then I have to jerk very expensive power plant, maybe even build it if I don't have 1,500 megawatts of gas plant, just to deal with these spikes. If I have this ability and the option on the demand side, then the same, you have fairly smooth gas response, okay? And then Nick did, so you can begin to think about storage the same way. Storage is another means of balancing. So there you need intelligence to say, do I do fast charging and increase the effective electric load so that power companies need to really build much more to compensate electric vehicles, or I'm a little smarter in this look-ahead way and I compensate and I don't need the. So there's a lot of work going on here on fast charging versus smart charging, and it's not hard at all. It's, again, distributed decision-making. For us, it's, again, what information to embed and et cetera. And I can go on. I sort of made it through half a talk, so I'm going to stop. But another big area, because you were asking about PMUs, as wind blows here, we can actually, this is the new technology on the communication side. This is what these PMUs are doing. You can put them in particular locations, the system. They sample in fast way. They are synchronized with the global position system. So you have, they're all synchronized samples. Then you can actually begin to regulate frequency or voltage or tie line flow control so that to compensate for these relatively fast 2-second fluctuations that you cannot predict on wind. You have to close the feedback loop. It's not anymore feed forward. And Zijian Liu is I think this was the first paper of its kind that showed how do you actually begin to close the loop using PMUs. Everybody is putting PMUs for situational awareness. I better stop here or else should I go for another 5 minutes? Okay, I will then skip. This would have been for Peter, fantastic to show him that how the models have changed when you put wind models. Some very, very terrible modeling, reduced modeling techniques. But I want to actually talk about this one for a minute because it brings home the idea that you can change the demand either in a look-ahead way over much slower timescale for feed-forward, or actually, you can begin to rely on the demand to begin to deal with inter-area oscillations or insufficient regulation capacity that you have on the generation side. So this is a simple example. We have to. Yes, yes, yes. And there's been a lot of long nights, but that's what's happening. So this is the old system, two control areas, and they have wind now. It's creating fluctuations. And if you go through simulations of models, etc., so inter-area oscillations can happen because this disturbance is creating back and forth exchange. And, you know, Peter, that's why I'm saying we really have to draw on the lot of knowledge that we know. Joe Chow, Peter, that was a golden era in Illinois when all these things were simulated. So now revisiting that stuff, you say, okay, now this is a much worse disturbance than in the past, right? So what can I do? So these are the power outputs of conventional power plants, and I can have some inter-area oscillations. The first thing is, if you don't have sufficient regulation capacity, this is what the utilities are scared of that from. If you wind blows and you don't have enough regulation, frequency will go outside of the acceptable bands. Okay, it gets even more interesting. Depending on if these two control areas are strongly connected or weakly connected, we had that discussion this morning. If the, this is, I don't know where Florian is. Yeah, here, yeah. So we need to talk about this. So what we know is that if these two things are weakly connected, then the inter-area oscillation and frequency deviation created in this area because of disturbance here are going to be relatively small, okay? If they are strongly connected, you have things all over the place, right? So you can have frequency oscillations in the neighboring utility created by the wind power plant elsewhere. And so basically, the point is that network constraints actually are beginning to affect the regulation of wind fluctuations. So you have to bring the locational aspect to this. So some of the stuff that I did when I, my early years at MIT was to actually talk about the basically extending AGC so that you have locational frequency measurements in quasi-static way. Now with PMUs, you can differentiate that. And if you start putting those models together, the whole thing comes together. So let's say this is the actual wind this is the actual wind output. Depending on how well you do the prediction, there may be fluctuations left which are zero mean or not zero mean. AGC now assumes that fluctuations are zero mean, but they may not be zero mean. And depending on how well you predict the wind output, you're going to have different fluctuations in wind, in frequency. And so the idea that I've been playing with for a long time now, and it's also in the book with Zaborski, is that in quasi-static setting, you can actually begin to differentiate with very accurate sensors, either frequency measurements at different generation locations. And if you do that, you can design, you know, more accurate LQG depending on more measurements than just assuming that frequency is the same in the entire area. And then what we call the vector-based frequency control. Then you can show that everything else the same, you can actually tighten the frequency deviations better if you have more sensing. I mean, makes sense from the control point of view. Took a lot of work to do. This is the one that I wanted to mention. This is where the sensors in washers come in. So the actual load consumed by the washer is the one that the work that washer has to do, plus something that responds to frequency deviation. So the load almost has its own droop characteristic, like the generator has. And if you have millions of those, then you can begin to put these models. I don't have time to design to talk about derivation, but this is vector model of frequencies where I measure, vector model of load frequency deviations where I measure them. And I can design LQG problem, because this is linearized for relatively small deviations, in which I can even put preferences, different allowed frequency deviations at different locations. I can put different penalties on cost depending on who charges how much for regulating the frequency. And I can begin to differentiate who is contributing to AGC, which we were actually never able to differentiate before. And to make the long story short, the same way as you have demand curves for energy, you can begin to have the demand and supply curves for. This is for participating in, this is the droop characteristic effectively, which comes out of the optimization of the resource deciding how much they sell energy, how much they participate in AGC. And depending on the technologies, they will respond at different rates. So let me stop here. There is much more to talk about here. I just want to close by saying that I think there is a lot of work to do. And you know, we would love to collaborate with people if there are some specific questions. Or I think we're just scraping the surface. But once you start looking into it, there's a lot that one can draw on the existing knowledge. So it's just a very careful posing the problem. And then a lot of stuff that's known in control can make the big difference. Thank you very much. Yes. Easier. Yes. Yes. That's what I was saying about going from DAEs to ODEs. Yes. So it's, I mean, we have a couple of conference papers on that that I want to, you know, I will send you. With Jose Mura, the signal processing guy, and his students, we've been working on this. I mean, it's straightforward. The question is, you don't want to put these PMUs everywhere. You know, where are the most critical locations, et cetera. So there is still a lot of systems work to be done as you design this. But the basic idea is that. Yeah. Yes?
It seems like the sole reason to have the at the end unit is because you have fluctuation in the generation, right? So, like we have, for example,
in intermittent generation, like it's solar and wind, that's the dominant reason, yeah. Yes. Yes, yes. Okay, so let me comment on this. So Schmuller, and again at Berkeley, is pushing this portfolio building. In other words, you have an intermittent resource. You combine it with some storage, with pumped hydro, with batteries, whatever. So they together are smooth. But effectively, you know, either storage or kite or something there. I don't know how. You need some storage, thermal or even solar in particular, to actually smooth out things. So it ultimately is the question, I think maybe the hardest question that we haven't even begun to work on very seriously, is how to aggregate these, you know, diverse resources and users so that they together, you know, behave in a better way. You know, they're smoother, so you don't need to make another, you know, resource. So it's true that if the rule is that everybody compensates locally, then you don't need to do anything else. But that may be an overkill because storage is very expensive. So it's boiled down to the trade-offs between the cost and the technical solution, things that we have not emphasized in the past, right? In other words, you have the best technical solution, doesn't really matter. And the other thing is that I'm very sensitive to this issue. People who push storage, large storage. They say, if I have storage, I solve the problem. Have you put any dollar value on, dollar costs on those? It's an expensive solution. Is there a way to squeeze more by just sensing what's happening and reacting just in time with something that's capable of adapting? That's what I'm talking about. And how to implement it. What information needs to be exchanged, what intelligence you need to embed, et cetera. But, you know, it's absolutely true what you said, yeah. Actually, just one more comment, that the microgrids that people are talking, you can have a neighborhood which is self-sufficient, can disconnect completely. Then you have storage with intermittent things, with solar and day, electric vehicles, they all compensate and everything is flat. So then this is more on a very larger large system, you know, when you don't have this perfect one-for-one balancing or group balancing itself. And that's the way it's been because, you know, AGC, you balance, doesn't matter where the imbalance is, you're compensating where you have the resource. And this is the generalization of that. Yes?
Thank you.
Well, so you remember that we had load aggregators and wholesale market and then the small users. So if the load aggregator is utility, right, there you have, in US, you have primarily flat price. That sort of blocks everything. You know, you don't see the benefit, et cetera. So you have to have, you know, more flexible contractual arrangements, which can be implemented. Like Pennsylvania now has opened the door to non-utility serving entities. So you can go and have an estimated contract that makes sense, et cetera. So then have to be regulated. You can just compete and serve your customers and meet the contractual agreements. There is really no systematic policy design to support IT-enabled efficiency. I mean, that's the bottom line. So when I just started looking into this many years ago at MIT, there was a woman who was working in communications in telecom, and she was doing similar issues on regulatory. Didn't make any sense to me at the time because I was not tuned to the question. But that's where it all stops unless you design it to support IT-enabled. So just a sort of generic comment on that, because there are a few departments, you know, at Stanford, at OR department, at MIT Engineering System Division, and CMU EPP. They are concerned with policies, but it's primarily scenario analysis. It's not the design of policy. You have to turn this question again. What slow feedback you need to give from the policy so that the system does something in technical terms? I'm sort of very excited about that idea, but very few people are posing it. I think Larry Hogg had long ago, he and Peter Liu had, Peter Liu's PhD thesis was a little bit on that incentive as a feedback control. And so there are things here and there that we can use as a starting point to suggest, but there's a huge disconnect. I think the fundamental problem is how to design simple coarse policy, which is actually going to give the incentive for something that's very detailed. You know, so I need something that maybe changes with season, et cetera, or rather than on split-second basis. Nobody is going to design these policies on that. So we have a big job there, too. But that's really a very important question.
Let me add that, speaking about a foreign versus U.S., 40 years ago, during my first sabbatical in Switzerland, close to 40 years ago, there were variable pricing with a programmable controller in houses, especially home heating. And you could program the controller to take so much energy, say, at 2 a.m., 2 a.m. to 4 a.m., et cetera, et cetera. These are primitive controllers, as you can imagine, switches and relays and so on. And then you mentioned Fred Chappie, unfortunately, who passed away too early. He, realizing this from MIT, professor, leader of energy group in the MIT, created this joint MIT around the very Swiss group.
Yes.
And we were exchanging the information, we were part of it. So much experience already was accumulated there. Now, the Swiss system has a very specific thing because they have a lot of hydro, and the hydro, the water was wasted overnight. So they wanted to sell as much energy during the night as possible. And they developed the high inertia heat reservoirs for your house so that you can pump it overnight and still enjoy heat during the daytime, et cetera, et cetera. So many of the ideas, as Marija is saying, to get these peaks smoothed by having reservoirs and inertias at the demand side and then programming. Much of this was working, has been working in the world. So as much as it was tried during the first boom, during the so-called energy independence project by President Carter, right, was tried and she called it boom number two, right? Much of this, the Department of Energy invited lots of foreign experts from Sweden, from Germany, from Switzerland. All these projects were actually planned by the Department of Energy and we had consultants at MIT, Illinois, and the other places. But then, when the government changed, they were all abolished. So she's right to worry about the bust. You know, there was a big bust after Carter. Announced even by the new president who came after Carter, whose name I will not mention. whoever comes after Obama, you may expect a bust again, so I don't know. But without a big federal
look at it inside into it, very little can be done. So that's the whole reality.
So it needs a political inertia.
Yes. Yeah, because 30 years, you know. It's
okay, we'll take one more question.
Two questions around my head, but I guess the one I'm more curious about is I think there are developing standards and protocols for communication between devices and the grid, and I'm wondering how those things are unfolding right now and how they relate to.
That's, I think, really an excellent question. NIST, National Institute of Standards, has an army of people working on this, and I, to the best that I can tell, it's really an effort to make sure that two devices produced by two different manufacturers actually talk to each other. That's where it ends. In all what we are talking about here, it assumes that you do that, right? That, you know, if I have to exchange between this and that, then they talk. So I've been on many panels recently with George Arnolds, who leads this on this side, and he finally came to one panel and he said, you know, we really have to talk about this because he just came from Japan, again, you know, the foreign efforts. And they opened, they started the program on control engineering for smart grids. He said, at NIST, we are not thinking about that way. We are just thinking about, can they talk, and then we are done. And so he said, and by listening to some of these ideas, how do you bring the control and systems part in? He said, we need to start something like that. So, I mean, it's not good enough to put the meter there, which is going to talk to the load aggregator. What do you do with that information? What information should be binding in terms of financial and technical performance, et cetera? That's what we are talking about. So, I mean, that's the part that somehow needs to be done, but much more needs to be done for things to work. That's the sort of answer that I have.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, yeah, all right.
Nice to
okay.
see you. I guess I didn't get you the flash drive anyway, but we'll be in touch because I still